الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to another episode of Classical Readings. We're continuing today with a book by Ibn Taymiyyah entitled السياسة الشرعية في إصلاح الراعي والرعية, which translates the politics of the Sharia for the reform of both the ruler and the ruled. In the last section, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah is talking about the hudud of Allah, or the fixed prescribed punishments of Allah. And the last section was about the inadmissibility of intercession. Once any of these cases reaches the ruler, there is no possibility of any change, whether through pardon or intercession or whatever. And then he just began talking about what about the one who repented before he's caught. Allah in the verse speaking about rebellion or muharaba, one who makes war against the rightful authorities in Islam, and this is one of the hudud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and its punishment. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ تَابُوا مِن قَبْلِ أَن تَقَدِرُوا عَلَيْهِمْ فَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Except for those who repent before you get power over them, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and merciful. So he said, illa, meaning implying that those are exempted from the punishment. Allah exempted only those who repented before being caught. So the one who repented after being taken into custody remains among those upon whom it is obligatory to carry out the punishment following the general statement, as well as the mafhum or the understood of this verse, in that Allah only exempted whom he exempted. This is where the evidence points. This is for the case where the crime is also established via evidence. If it is only based on confession, meaning that the perpetrator comes confessing his crimes and repenting at the same time, about this case there is a difference of opinion discussed at length elsewhere. The apparent opinion in the school of Ahmed is that it is not obligatory to inflict the punishment in this scenario, and there are a couple of very strong hadith which support this position. Rather, if the individual requests it, it should be done, but if they leave, they should be left alone and no punishment is required. So we're talking about the case where one comes and confesses and repents at the same time. The story of Ma'iz al-Aslami relates to this. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said that innahu qad zana. He said, I have committed zina. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned away from him to another direction and didn't listen to him. He continued to doing this till the third or fourth time, when Ma'iz kept saying this, that he had committed zina. So finally, فَأَمَرَ بِهِ فِي الرَّابِعَ فَأُخْرِجَ بِهِ إِلَى الْحَرَّ فَرُجِمَ بِالْحِجَارَةِ. So the Prophet ﷺ, on the fourth time, he said, okay, and he ordered that he be taken out to the Harra. These are the black stones outside of Medina, the volcanic stones. And he ordered him to be stoned to death for the had which he had confessed to. But when he felt the pain of the stones, and when he realized, you know, about his approaching death, he ran away. He tried to run very hard. But he passed by someone who had a large object, and he knocked him down with it, and the people continued to stone him until he was dead. They went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they told him what had happened, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, هَلَا تَرَكْتُمُ. Say, why didn't you leave him? So this is a very important hadith for understanding the hudud of Allah and how they are applied. This hadith is valid. It is a hasan hadith. And in it, the Prophet ﷺ suggested, even though the had, the punishment had been ordered, but the man came on his own, confessed on his own, and repented. And when he changed his mind and tried to run away, the Prophet ﷺ said that they should have left him to run away instead of finishing off the execution. So this is the understanding of his statement, if only you had left him. In the above hadith, also his action in Sahih Bukhari. Another case which everyone should know who wants to understand about the hudud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, إِنِّي أَصَبْتُ حَدًّا فَأَقِمْ عَلَيَّ الْحَدْ. He said, I have violated one of the boundaries of Allah, so you must inflict the punishment on me. And the Prophet ﷺ did not even ask what he's talking about. He didn't ask what he had done or anything like that. And then the time for Salah came. And so all of them made Salah, including this man and including the Prophet. فَلَمَّا قَضَى النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ قَامَ إِلَيْهِ الرَّجُلُ فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِنِّي أَصَبْتُ حَدًّا. When he finished making his Salah, the man came to him again and said, O Messenger of Allah, I have violated one of the boundaries of Allah. فَأَقِمْ فِيَّ. So establish the punishment upon me. أَقِمْ فِيَّ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. I want you to implement the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on me. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَيْسَ قَدْ صَلَّيْتَ مَعْنَا. He said, didn't you just make Salah with us? قَالَ نَعَمْ. He said, yes, I did. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ غَفَرَ لَكَ ذَنْبَكَ أَوْ قَالَ حَدَّكَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, verily Allah has forgiven you whatever it is that you did. Whatever sin or violation you did, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven it. So these hadith and others like them are vital to truly understand the concept of the hudud Allah, hudud of Allah, and how they are implemented. There are other such reports. It is recorded in Abu Dawud and in Nasa'i that Abdullah ibn Umar reported, ta'afu al-hudud fima baynakum. Forgive one another issues of the hudud of Allah. فَمَا بَلَغَنِي مِنْ حَدٍ فَقَدْ وَجَبْ. For any had crime, any of the hudud of Allah which reaches me, it must be. There is no possibility of return. And from the same sources, reported by Abu Huraira, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, حَدٌ يُعْمَلُ بِهِ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَيْرٌ لِأَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ مِنْ أَنْ يُمْتَرُوا أَرْبَعِينَ صَبَاحًا. A boundary of Allah which is implemented and practiced in the earth is better for the people of the earth than 40 days of plentiful rain. And this hadith too is Hasan. This is because disobedience in society is a cause of shortages of material things and fear of enemies, as is clearly indicated by the Quran and the Sunnah, and as the author has spoken of earlier in this book. So when the boundaries are enforced, obedience to Allah is increased, and disobedience and sin are decreased, and so wealth and security are obtained and protected for the Muslims. It is not lawful to accept any payment or property from a convicted adulterer, thief, public drunk, highway robber, and the like, in order to defeat the prescribed punishment of the had, the boundary. This is the case whether the money is paid to the treasury or to any other recipient. Any such property received in order to defeat the application of any of the boundaries of Allah is graft and it is foul. If the ruler does that, he has combined two grievous acts of corruption. Number one, failing to apply the law, and number two, consuming something foul or suht, i.e. bribery. So he failed to fulfill the obligatory and he committed the unlawful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, speaking about the nations before us, لَوْلَا يَنْهَاهُمْ الرَّبَّانِيُّونَ وَالْأَحْبَارُ عَنْ قَوْلِهِمُ الْإِثْمِ وَأَكْلِهِمُ السُّحْتِ لَبِئْسَ مَا كَانُوا يَصْنَعُونَ. Why then did not their rabbis and scholars forbid them the speaking of sinful things and the consumption of foul wealth? How evil is that which they used to do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Bani Israel, سَمَّعُونَ لِلْكَذِبِ أَكَّلُونَ لِلسُّحْتِ. Forever listening to lies and forever consuming foul wealth. This was said regarding their consuming of the foul in the form of bribes, which they used to call الْبَرْطِيلِ. And sometimes they are called gifts and other things. The Prophet ﷺ in the hadith, لَعْنَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ الرَّاشِي وَالْمُرْتَشِي وَالرَّائِشِ الْوَاسِطَ الَّذِي يَمْشِي بَيْنَهُمَا. The Prophet ﷺ cursed the one who gives a bribe and the one who receives a bribe and the one who intercedes between them for this purpose. In the two books of Sahih, it is reported that two men came to the Prophet ﷺ seeking a judgment. رَجُلَيْنِ اخْتَصَمَا إِلَى رَسُولِ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. They came to him for judgment and they said, O Messenger of Allah, judge between us by the book of Allah. And then one of them said, إِنِّ ابْنِي كَانَ عَسِيفًا فِي أَهْلِ هَذَا. My son was working as a servant in the family of this one. يعني أجيراً فَزَنَى بِامْرَأَتِهِ. So he committed zina with his wife. فافتديت منه بمئة شاة وخادم. And I paid a ransom of 100 sheep and one slave for this event which occurred. وإن رجلا من أهل العلم أخبرني أن على ابني جلد مئة وتغريب عام. But someone from the scholars informed me that my son must be punished with 100 lashes and exile from the community for 1 year. وأن على امرأتي هذا الرجم, and that the wife of this one must be stoned according to the Sharia. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَقَضِيَنَّ بَيْنَكُمَا. By the one in whose hand my soul is, I will pass judgment between them. بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ, by the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الْمِئَةُ وَالْخَادِمُ رَدٌّ عَلَيْكَ. The 100 sheep and the slave is returned to you. وَعَلَى ابْنِكَ جَلْدُ مِئَةٍ وَتَغْرِيبُ عَامٍ. And your son must be lashed 100 lashes and exiled for 1 year. وَغْدُ يَا أُنَيْسِ على امرأتي هذا فاسألها فإن اعترفت فرجمها فسألها فاعترفت فرجمها. So he sent somebody, go to the wife of this one and ask her, does she confess to this act? And if she does, then punish her with the stoning. The man went and she did confess to the act and she was subsequently stoned. In this hadith we see that when he paid money on behalf of the perpetrator, in order to keep him from the punishment, the Prophet ﷺ ordered all of that returned to its owner, and he ordered for the law to be carried out. He did not take the money for the Muslims in general, or for the treasury, whether for defense of the land, the needy, or any other expenditure, and there is a consensus that any wealth taken from one subject to punishment under the law, whether adulterer, thief, public drunk, rebel, or gangster and the like, in order to obstruct the application of the law, such wealth is suht, it is foul and it is unlawful. We'll finish from this point inshallah in the next episode of Classical Readings. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.